Just a quick disclaimer before the episode begins. So during the revolution's 10th anniversary, I was going through an album of pictures on Facebook taken in Tahrir Square, and I happened to find Jonathan in one of the pictures, and he was tagged, so his account was there. So I thought, why not have him on the podcast? So we made it happen. Enjoy the podcast. Welcome to the Egyptian Hulk podcast. In this episode, the first guest we have is Jonathan Pai, an Egyptian Swede who happened to be in Egypt during the Egyptian Revolution. And in this episode, he'll be telling us, telling me about the experiences and the stories and everything he's been through in Egypt and in Palestine. Also, as he told me when we met prior to recording this podcast. And I hope you enjoy it, and I'm really looking forward to it. So, Jonathan, introduce yourself.
I am now a 44-year-old archaeologist. Actually, my line of work took a little bit part of what I did in Egypt, not that I in any way did any digs or so, but we used me being an archaeologist to get through checkpoints, but I'll come back to that. I'm also politically interested and socialist, and I had been active in a movement called the ISM, International Solidarity Movement, in Palestine.
Mm. And what took you there to Palestine in 2008, as you told me?
Ooh, I had friends who had been before. There is actually a lot of solidarity work between Sweden and Palestine. And the way ISM works is that you have a Palestinian-led committee. So we wouldn't be like Europeans going to a conflict zone and having our own views and just imposing it on the local population, but it would be Palestine-led. And also it needed to be non-violent, because if we in any way took up violence against the Israelis, it would just shut down the whole movement. But mainly we would do things that the Palestinian need. Like what I did there was mainly olive harvesting, because most villages have their olive groves and trees close to the settlements. And the Israeli settlers would shoot at Palestinian farmers farming their olives. But if there would be white people there, like obvious tourists or people from Europe, they couldn't shoot me, because they couldn't get away with that. So yes, in a way, yes. I was a human shield, you could say. Also, I would always be, when the military came there, to say like, why are you here? This is a shut off area. This is a security area. These might be terrorists. I would be like, yeah, but these are my friends. We will just harvest the olives. This will take a day or two maximum. Please just let be. And mostly this would work. And I thought this was a very effective way of doing. I could see how my personal input made the difference. I mean, if you go in a demonstration, like in a protest, and shout, you can't really. I mean, you're just one of 1,000 people, and often nothing happens. But in this way, it was very down-to-earth, practical. And this was also why I chose to go to Egypt, although I've never been before, although I had no proper contacts or anything.
But let's pause and go back a little bit. Yes. So deciding you chose to go to Palestine in 2008,
Yes.
How did you feel prior to traveling there? What was going on in your head? Did you think that maybe you won't come back again? Maybe you'll be killed there, for example? What was going on in your head?
In my the organization I had joined, ISM, there had been two people killed by them from like on the westerner side, one called Tim Randall and one called Rachel Curry. But that was in during the Second Intifada and during the occupation of Gaza. So that was in much more
action.
So in the time when I went, it was I thought it would be probable that I wouldn't be shot at with live bullets. At the training, they said they would probably just shoot tear gas at you and rubber bullets, so you will probably not die. But actually, a friend of mine had been shot with live ammo, but they use low-caliber live ammo that normally don't kill you. So I wasn't super revolutionary who wanted to die on the barricades. I thought this will probably be fine, and also if situations would be too dangerous, I would be able to back off. Normally, the Palestinians got the brunt of every violence, and we would be able to stand aside a little.
And how long did you stay there?
For 4 months, maybe not quite 4 months, but 3.5, I think.
And after that, you went back to Sweden?
Then I went back to Sweden.
And then from Sweden, you came to Cairo, right?
Yes, but that was, this was 2008, so I did, I needed to get money. I worked and things. The reason, in the end, I went to the square, to the protest only for 1 week. I wasn't there during the whole stretch of time. I wasn't actually. I went back to Sweden before Mubarak stepped down. And the reason for that was that I had a job I needed to keep for money, and I called in sick. I called my boss. I feel a little sick. I need to stay home for a while, and then I just went to Egypt. And after a week, they started calling me and like, "Are you? How sick are you really? When can you come back to job?" I'm like, "Okay, I actually need to go back to work, or we'll be fired." And at that point, things at the square had been calming down a little. But that's. Maybe I should just take it from going to Egypt.
Yes. What day exactly did you come?
Well, I met up with my friend Shoah, who was also very intended on going, and what that was on the last of January. The protests started for real in the 25th, I think, of January.
The 28th.
Maybe 28th, yeah.
Yes, the 28th when police retreat. Yeah, go ahead.
No, it's just, so we saw the information in television, and we had the problem with that the tourist flights from Sweden, the normal, like, go to Egypt and have a nice holiday in the sun, they stopped. They said this is too dangerous. We can't insure. We because of insurance, we can't be sure we can send people anymore. So we needed to take a special flight with almost only us and one Swedish journalist on, I think. And
I'm sorry. When day was that exactly?
It was the 2nd of February. So we arrived the 2nd of February in the airport, but that was late afternoon. And first we had a problem with some sort of like a paper to be allowed out inside of Egypt, and they wanted us to pay a fee for that, and we were like, we got loads of Egyptian pounds, and they said no, it's $15 American dollars. I'm like, This is Egypt, why on earth would you need the American dollars for a official paper? I'm pretty sure that it was some sort of bribe. I think the official just wanted money he could use in a. Anyways, we need this this one Swedish journalist that we did not know at all. He said, "I've been to Egypt before. I have enough American dollars, so you can you pay me in Egyptian pounds, and you'll get your dollars." Anyways, then there was a curfew. You weren't allowed to walk the streets at night. Yes, so let's get into action. But everyone said, no. You need to stay at the airport until morning. So we had to stay in the airport, and I think the curfew broke at 9 or something in the morning.
Yes,
and we took a taxi. We just sat down in a taxi and said, "Can you please take us to Tahrir Square?"
And you didn't have any reservations at a motel or a hotel or anything?
No. We didn't know how to. We were very unprepared, actually. And the cab driver said, "No, you can't go to the square. You're crazy. It's closed off, and there's riots everywhere, and they might hurt my car, and they will hurt you. I refuse. I won't drive you to the square. It's not possible." So we said, "Okay, just drop us off as close as possible that you find safe, and we'll have to walk them." So we were dropped off somewhere and had our bags with our stuff. We didn't bring a lot of stuff, but still, we just started walking in the direction of the square to join the protests. Also, I mean, we had a few names of people we could reach out to for that weren't friends, but were sort of friends of friends of friends who were in the protests, or
Egyptians?
Cairo. Egyptians, yes. Well, my girlfriend at the time, or actually my girlfriend now, she had a friend she met through some sort of youth exchange program, and she still had contacts with her, but she didn't know if she was involved in the protests or not. So for the moment, we just headed off for the square. And the first thing that happened was that an angry mob of around 100 persons just swarmed us. Because I was very obviously, my friend Shola, he's Swedish, but his parents are from Iran. So he could look more like Egyptian if needed, but I was very obviously a foreigner.
But one second, when did that happen? Once you arrived to the square?
February, we are not in the square yet.
Yes, where did that happen?
This is maybe 300-400 meters outside of the square. And there's been there are barricades on the edges of the square, but then there are checkpoints outside of these barricades.
Military checkpoints or civilian
checkpoint? It was security forces. But these security. People, the people who warned us, and they were civilians with iron sticks and clubs and things. But they had said, "You are American spies." And they started taking our bags and looking to, and then they saw I had a camera. They were like, "Yeah, this is." But then there was, and they most of them did not speak English. But then they had a leader. It was 100 civilians, but one was an officer.
How did you know?
Because he introduced himself. He said, I'm an officer of the, a security officer. And why are you here? What are you doing here?
Mm.
And me and Shoan used, in Spanish, there is an expression, harsh el sueco. It means playing the Swede. It also means playing stupid. So we were like, yeah, no, we're from Sweden. We don't understand anything. We are just walking around in Egypt. And what is this? And and we showed our Swedish passports to this officer. The moment I understood this is for real, this isn't just a protest that you want to join and help out with, was that beside this security officer in the side of the street were three men. And to me, they looked dead, but they could be just unconscious. And they had coarse iron cables strapped around their hands on their backs. So they were all backbound and lying in the streets, three of them just beside this officer. I'm like, this is, I hope I won't end up like this. but what happened, we showed our passports and said we've always been interested in Egypt and what a lovely city Cairo is. And he was like, this, you are in the wrong spot. This is not where you should be. And then this officer called a taxi, another taxi, and forced him to come as close as we were, and said, these two tourists need to go to a proper tourist hotel where they can enjoy the niceties of Egypt without I can't really remember. And we just agreed to this because we, at this point, we thought, let's not argue with this man. And the mob of civilians, they said, can we at least take his camera? And they were like, no, this will look bad. We need the Egyptian government to look good in internationally right now. So let him have his camera. I don't remember. Maybe he took us to a specific hotel, as an expensive hotel. We went. Sweden is sort of a rich country, but we, as kids, students with bad jobs, we didn't have a lot of money. So, and he took us to, I think, to a sort of a luxury hotel far off.
Do you remember its name?
In some way, we may. Do you know your way? You're not from. Do you know your way about around the areas of Cairo?
Kind of.
Yes, there is an island called Smalek.
Yes.
So we managed to come there, and that this is rather close to Tahrir Square. So I'm not sure where the officer wanted us to go, because this wasn't actually far off. But we at least found a reasonably cheap hotel and started to try to contact people. And at this point, I had I knew a computer hacker, and he said, we have a special system you can use to go online in Egypt, because they shut down the normal internet. But we opened up a special hacker's internet from Sweden. So
at the hotel or?
No. This was actually the there was students in Gothenburg, and they by using old modems, they called up faxes in Egypt, and through that you could reach international internet instead of the like cut down one that Mubarak had restricted.
Yes.
But at the point when we arrived, I think the restrictions had sort of already were lifted, because as I remember, we didn't really have problems joining, like seeing international internet at the time. Well, anyways, this evening of the 3rd of February, we were already a little shaken, and we said we have been a little bit stupid about just walking towards the square when people said this is dangerous. We need to listen to when people warn us, and we need to plan a little ahead when we want to join the protest. So that evening, also it was curfew. That evening we just tried to reach people that we could, Egyptians that would be able to tell us how to join in the protests. And I don't remember if we could reach them at that point or not. I think not, because the next day we just tried another approach, like another way. And that was probably, suddenly it was easy. We just took a bridge from Smalek over in the direction of the square, and we were searched by the military, because there were tanks who tried to keep, like, this the whole protest was sort of supervised by the military without the military doing much of protection or like attacks on either the police or the thugs. They were, I mean, the sort of government forces that I saw in Egypt were very little, either police or security forces, only this officer. It was mainly like paid thugs, like people who were paid by the government to try to attack and intimidate the protests. Mm-hmm. And for us, it was very complicated because everyone was using Egyptian flags as their symbol. If you were a Muslim Brotherhood, you'd have a Egyptian flag. If you were some sort of like Western Democrat liberalist, you would have an Egyptian flag. If you were a strong communist or socialist, you would have an Egyptian flag. And the thugs that attacked us and said you are like infiltrators, they would also have Egyptian flags. So it was hard to see who was a friend and who wasn't. But at least what happened was also the military, the first time we tried to get through, they said, no, you can't, because you have a camera and we cannot allow cameras, which was sort of stupid because exactly everyone had cell phones. So with their mobile phones, they would photograph and film everything. But the camera, for some reason, was still forbidden. So we had to go back to our hotel, leave that, and come back. And finally, we were in the square. Mm.
What day is that? 3rd of February?
This is the 4th of February.
Mm. And then when you entered?
And it was very... when we entered, it was very nice because something happened that I've never seen in another protest before, that there were rows of people like in a funnel who would just stand and all clap their hands and be like, you're welcome, please come in and smile at us. You and I was like, this is great. We should, every protest anywhere should have this like welcoming committee. And partly I think they had that because then you had to go through lines of people who would frisk you to see that you wouldn't have, like, there were always threats about, like suicide bombers, or at least like agents who would come in with guns, and they wanted to and we were fine with that. We were extra frisked because we looked suspicious, and there's all they had also been talk about that the revolution wasn't the real people of Egypt standing up to the dictator, but instead it was Israeli and American agents, like from Mossad and CIA, who tried to rile up discontent among the masses. So some people were thinking, this is, look, him there, he might be Mossad, and the other guy, he's CIA. it was great. The feeling was great. Everyone was very happy. There wasn't so people, they weren't so frightful, at least in the daytime at this point, at 4th of February. I think the main battles or the main confrontations had died down. So it was mainly to keep the spirit up, and the things were very well organized. I remember there were people picking litter from the streets to make sure that it was sort of clean. There had been some looting of, because I'm an archaeologist. I was sad to hear that the Egyptian museum had been looted, but when we arrived, there were protection both from military tanks and by the protesters themselves, who made sort of a barrier.
Yes, and actually before the military was deployed to protect places of national interest, people actually stood around the Egyptian museum and protected it themselves.
I can imagine that. I mean, yes. the tanks were there, they did not do much good or bad. Actually, at some points there were rumors that the tanks would move out or do things, and people just sat around them so they couldn't move, so they were not very efficient anyways. But most people were we can't fight the military, they are too strong, we need to keep the peace with them, because that's
and actually on that point, besides that they are strong, the military is actually Egypt. You know, every household almost has one or two or three members of the military, whether they are officers or they are conscripts, because in Egypt, the law demands that you serve in the military for a year or 3 years if you have a brother, you know. Yeah. So it's kind of part of Egyptian society and Egyptian culture. No, it's not very segregated.
No, of course. Also, when I talked to, I spoke to loads of people in the square, of course. Mm. And they were very, they were sort of cautious in the way they talked about what the protests were about. Everyone was like, yeah, we need to get out, Mubarak out. And then I tried to see a little bit more of what is wrong, what you want. I mean, it's not, you want a proper democratic society, and you want justice. And people were like, yeah, maybe we're not really calling for justice right now. And the reason for this was that there was a very fragile agreement between the Muslim Brotherhood and the, let's say, democratic protesters. They wanted to keep the peace among themselves, but they knew this peace is very fragile and can break up at any moment. So this, the liberals and socialists, they would say, yeah, we at this point we're not talking much about justice and like redistribution of wealth or so. We just need to get the police and dictator out. This is the first step. And also when we slept that first night, we weren't sure if we would come back again, if we had just been lucky to be let into the square. So we're like, let's stay at this place and sleep here. And we chose just a free spot on a lawn where we could lie down and sleep. And like early in the morning, a guy woke up, not me, but he was shaking my friend Shoan and said, like, this is, it's morning prayer. What are you doing? It's prayer time. And Shoan was like, answered in English, I'm sorry, I don't speak Arabic. And this guy, he was from the Muslim Brotherhood. He was like, oh no, I made like a secular protester to try to make them pray. This is like, I can't do that because this will break the unity between the socialists and the Muslims. So he just jumped back and was like, no, go back to sleep. No problem. I'll go and pray. Sorry. So they were like boats. And we couldn't see. Again, we couldn't. There was a division in the square. Everyone was friendly, but the Muslim Brotherhood kept to one side and the other protesters kept to another side. And we couldn't see the difference, really. So we had gone to sleep in the Muslim Brotherhood sort of part of the square because we found a spot there. Mm. That's why he had woken my like Egyptian-looking friend for this. Yeah. And then at some point, yeah, I remember there were two different sound systems for speeches, and there was, you could see that there was singing only in the like the democratic side, and there were speeches and prayers on the Muslim Brotherhood side. That was one of the few, because we don't, neither me or Shoan speaks any Arabic. He's tried a little bit of Persian because there are some similar words, and I tried the very rudimentary Arabic I learned in Palestine. But even things like yes, I would say Iowa, and people would tell me, no, it's not. But I mean, in the daytime, most people we met were students, and they spoke excellent English.
Do you remember any conversations you had with one of them?
Yes, I spoke with loads of people. I remember very well at nighttime, because there were loads of like poor kids. In the daytime, there were there were highly educated students, but they went home to their own beds at night, and the people guarding the barricades, the actual like on the barricades revolutionary, they were, yes, many, yes, of them were poor street kids, and they spoke very little or no English at all, but they were very curious about me and Shoan and what we were doing there and what our country was like and what football teams we were supporting and things. There was a teacher there, an old man. He was not that old, maybe 55 or so. And he said, "For my whole generation, we let things slide and we let things go bad in Egypt, and we were too cowardly to protest properly. And now, when the youth finally steps up, we really need to support them, even if I'm a little too like stiff in my bones to run properly and to fight off the thugs. I still stand here and I can still guard the fire. There was like a fire to keep it warm at night. And he also sort of found the stories of the street kids fascinating about why they were protesting and what they wanted and out of life and things. I mean, it was easy things. They wanted to have like a opportunity to work without hassle from police, and they wanted to just be able to buy standard stuff and things like that. But he also spoke about the importance of Egypt, how loads of I didn't know, but he said the most literature, Arabic literature, comes from Egypt. You won't have the same amount of poetry or novels or stuff coming out of Tunisia or Saudi Arabia or Arabia or something. What happens in Egypt is important for all of like the Arab Spring also with
I understand.
And then we went back to our hotel at some point because we were fed. The people had like free maklube for everyone all the time. And me and Shawan, we said like the one thing that people who have traveled to Egypt and who are from Sweden all say is that they get sick. They all get some sort of belly, like
virus
or bacteria that we can't handle because we are unused to them. And now we have like tons of food standing in the heat of the sun, and people are just handing it out, and it's wonderful. But also, it's a little bit how will we be able to handle this? And actually, there was never a problem. All the food was apparently very cleanly made, so and for some reason we were okay with this.
That's the effect of the revolution, man.
Probably. Yeah. Revolutionary virus and bacteria supported the revolution. The reason we wanted to go to the square in the first place was, I mean, no one would care about one or two Swedes. We would make no numeric difference, but we wanted, I think, three things. One was just to tell everyone, because there had been sort of a internet blackout, and we wanted to make sure that everyone knew that the whole world outside of Egypt was actually interested and were on the side of the protests, because that might be good for morale for people who sat and felt lonely in the square, that the eyes of the world was on the protest and it was sympathetic to the protest mainly. So that was one thing. Also, the same thing I had been doing in Palestine. I thought whenever there's clashes, if I am in the front or if I am visible, they will see. It might make them hesitate to kill foreigners, if they are like European foreigners, because maybe the European countries would make a fuss. The third reason was just to give proper material support if there was any need. So when I started speaking to people, I said, well, is there anything you need? Is there something that is problematic with staying on the square that we for in any way can help with? And they said, well, there's a hospital. We made a impromptu hospital in one of the buildings adjacent to the square. So we went to the hospital and said, like, hello, we are from Sweden. Would you need anything? Do you have any? And I was saying, I was thinking they would say anything. Give us just money or any kind of medical supplies would be nice. Or they would say, yeah, we are sort of fine. Thank you for your support. But they just looked me in the eyes and said, pulse oximeters.
I'm like, what did you do? I didn't hear that.
What's a pulse oximeter? They said, no, this is an important device, and you can't get them in Egypt anymore. We've got loads of money. There's rich people everywhere sends us the money. We don't need money. Mm. We don't need supplies. We have too many supplies. We can't fit any supplies in. We need pulse oximeters and nothing else. And we're like, okay, great. We have a quest. We have a, like, this is what we do. We will get you pulse oximeters. So what we did next was go home to a hotel, take, actually, I think we slept at the hotel that night. We were like, okay, let's regain our strength and have a shower and call home to Sweden and tell people what we need, if there will be a second wave, because we were very quick in leaving, but some people, not from where I stayed at the moment, Malmö, but some people was from Stockholm said, we also want to go. If you can reach the square without dying, then we also want to go. And I said, yeah, great. You need to bring pulse oximeters. Just rally money and then buy pulse oximeters and take them to the square. And then we've managed our quest. And what happened?
And did they succeed in doing that?
Yes, but they arrived much later. Just I think they came on the 11th, the day he stepped down. But there was still happiness about. I mean, I saw a photo of the impromptu hospital and giving of these, I think they managed to buy 8 of them. That's not many, but it was enough for what was needed at the time. And this when we've been to the hotel and wanted to go back again, there was new. The military always had different approaches. Sometimes they didn't know really what to do with us. Sometimes they just let us through without anything, and sometimes we were really questioned. And we were also not sure when was curfew and not. So we sometimes we were out and about when no one was supposed to be in the street. And actually, my friend Showan started up with a routine where he said, we are, this is a professor of archaeology. I'm not a professor at all. I'm just plain archaeologist. And it's very important for him to reach the offices inside of central Cairo. And they looked at us very suspiciously. And then I started talking about, like, yeah, I'm studying Alestenar in southern Sweden. It is a Stone Age construction, and I think they have some sort of inspirations from Egyptian pyramids. Of course, our Swedish archaeology is much more crude, not as sophisticated, not as good at all. But I want to make this like connection between the Egyptian excellence in building pyramids and the crappy Swedish Stone Age structures. And I'm going to write my thesis about this. And the militaries were like, ah, so you want to, you're writing about why Egypt is so much better than, or were so much better in ancient time than Sweden. This sounds like very important research to us. And they let us through all the time. We, through this small story, we were always let through. We're also showing Swedish passports, of course, but still, it was like a small theater we had to do to go through checkpoints. And then I think in the whole time, we were only attacked properly. There was the and when we were in the square, there's a bridge where enemies to the revolution, like Mubarak thugs, would stand and throw stones towards us. But this bridge, from that bridge, you could hardly make any difference, or like it was mostly symbolic. The stones never reached us properly. But sometimes they tried to like storm the square. And I remember, I think, two proper times where we like did this second part of why we were there, to be in front line when people attacked. Both of the time it was rather dark at night, so we were like out there defending the square, throwing stones at the attackers and stuff. But I was thinking, the main thing of me being a white Swede, this doesn't matter. They would shoot me as much as anyone else because it's just pitch dark. No one can see who I am, or if it would be a diplomatic problem.
It seems like you really enjoy being a human shield.
Yeah, well, in a way, I could say you can say I enjoyed it, because I felt that was much more
effective,
efficient, or like making a difference if you compare to what you. I could write a story. I could be a journalist saying like, these are beautiful people trying to reach freedom. But I'm like, there's 1,000 people doing this at this moment. But they won't. What they won't do is stand in the first line when the Mubarak thugs attacks, and I could do that. So I'll make that. Also, I will get the pulse oximeters. Those two things I can do, and that will, it won't make a real difference, but it will make more of a difference than just shouting slogans. Yeah. But then everything quieted down, and very little happened for a while. There were like, we were standing around and still talking to people, still eating free maklouba. But I managed to reach these people who were friends of my girlfriend, and they lived out in Heliopolis. But we said, yeah, let's meet up with them, and just because, yeah. And that was also interesting, because they were sort of in favor of the protests, but really, and they were not fans of Mubarak, but they were like, the good old days of Nasser. That is what we want. We like the whole friendship of them were like. Everything was easier in the time of Nasser. And I'm like, but you are young people. Do you even remember him? And they were like, yeah, well, life was lovely when I was a kid. That was sort of their view of things. And that's maybe also a reason that the military is held in such a regard, that there is sort of Nasserites still around. I don't know. And actually, with them, we took one day off. We had like, they were like, yeah, you've been in the square and you've been talking to people.
One second. Who the friends of here, your girlfriend's friends in Heliopolis?
They were living in Heliopolis, and they said, you are an archaeologist. At least you can take you can have one day off your revolution. You can have one day of vacation. We'll take you to the pyramids. You have to have seen the pyramids. So we were only protesting for 7 days, and one of those days we had like a vacation from the protest. And but and it wasn't much. We couldn't, the whole pyramid had been shut down, or you couldn't go in because there were no tourists around anyways. But it was, I liked the fact I could say that I saw them. But mostly this friend, he said when we came there and there were police saying, yeah, you can take photos of the pyramids, it's okay. There's no problem. And he later told me they wanted to be bribed. They wanted money to not make a problem out of this. But this is new times now. I won't bribe police anymore for just doing normal stuff. This is the new Egypt, and they will have to survive on their salaries. They can't just force people to pay them bribes anymore. And on the way back,
do you remember what day was that?
This was the 8th of February. And I remember on the way back, we were listening to radio. And there is this, all over the world, I think, they have, in Sweden, we have a radio station called Riks FM. And I heard them saying Nile FM in Egypt. I'm like, this is the same. This is like a very standard commercial radio station. But actually, at this point, everyone had left. So there was just one old guy still in the radio, and he played his own like sort of hippie, sort of his own old style rock. And that felt, for me, that felt like this is actually not just any protest. This is, in a way, it's revolution. When the radio like starts playing revolution music because everyone else left because there's nothing. And then, as I said, already on the 9th of February, before Mubarak even stepped down, I got so pressured by my work that if I wouldn't come back, they wouldn't let me back. So we said, okay, we'll make sure the pulse oximeters arrive. We will make an appointment with this hospital and make sure these people from Stockholm know where to go. And then we'll let them do the revolution for a while. And I went back to Sweden.
When did you go back?
The 9th of February.
Just 2 days before.
It was just 2 days before. I could have waited two more days. Probably I would have been fired. It would have been great. But at the time, at the point, it seemed like it could be stretching forever.
But as an experience, do you think it still echoes in your life till this day?
Oh, very much, actually. In a way, I mean, it's sad that we tried to protest and nothing got better in the end. So it's not... It's not only a positive experience, but this feeling of freedom when people start organizing everything themselves, and there's like a new, like the government of the square I mean, there were also bad things. At some point, there was a rape of a journalist I later read. So everything, of course, isn't great in these circumstances. But what I met was like this vibrant energy of hope and cooperation.
And do you still think about it?
Yeah, actually, because of the 10 years anniversary, I have gotten like... Facebook tells me, yeah, you were in Egypt 10 years ago. And I mean, now I have two kids and I'm not really, I don't jump on planes to go and our kids as much. And and I haven't had the opportunity. Now we have the pandemics and everything. I haven't really had the opportunity to go back to Egypt either. But yeah, I mean, things like the people who welcome you into the square and applaud you, and also when you every time you went out of the square and they were like, yeah, thank you for being here, welcome back, come back anytime, also applaud you. This is just a very easy and small thing, but it was just great. I want to implement that on any protest anywhere. Now they're protesting in Burma. I'll ask people there to make such a welcome and saying goodbye committee. It's a good way to keep up the spirits. Oh.
Good. And if you could
this photo, the way you found me. It was taken by English Egyptian socialists I met.
And what's his name?
It's a woman. I just forgot. I will find her name. And it's me and my friend, and I think we have two. We have a post, a sign each, or maybe I have a sign.
Yes, I remember this one.
Yeah, and this is because Sweden is a country that's sort of they want to show off as like a very nice, peaceful, democratic, top of the crop, fair and just country. But just the year 2009, they had been selling ammunition to Egypt for 1 million euros. So that's why my sign says stop the Swedish. I think it's maybe it's written even in Swedish.
Yes, I remember it's written in Swedish.
Stop the hypocrisy of the Swedish weapon industry. And my friend's sign says only cut the dick of Mubarak. He was more like upfront. I was supposed to find her name. Because it also in for a short while her photo of us was in the Wikipedia of the protests, and then someone said, "Yeah, these two Swedes, they are not really representative of what was going on. I mean, they were proper like Egyptians who lost their lives and everything. Let's not put them in this like." To make too much out of them, and I can see how that's correct. Let's see. I wanted to see what happened 10 years ago.
Is she the one that uploaded the picture that
yes,
I sent
yes,
you?
Yes.
I know her.
Okay.
Yes. So, on a closing remark, we'll be closing now, but I just want you to say one thing before we close up. If you could describe this whole experience in one sentence, what would it be?
It was amazing to take part of the bravery of the Egyptian people. Even though this revolution came in the end sort of to nothing, it was still... This is the long sentence, but it's the one sentence. it was still worth it. That's my thoughts.
Right. Thank you, Jonathan, for coming on the podcast. I hope listeners enjoy it as much as we enjoyed having this conversation. And I hope everyone would be able to understand my very Egyptian accent.
Thank you very much for having me. It was great reliving these moments